Yeah, thanks for the introduction and hi to everyone here. Now, a psychologist is going to talk about AI. Do you really trust me with that? I mean, who do you actually trust? Think of those people that you really trust. Many of us will maybe now think of family, of partners, but trust is also very, very central in your relation to your doctors, to your colleagues. In every situation where you say, there is something important that I want someone else to do for me, help me with, where I want some advice on. And if you think of those colleagues, if you think of those doctors, where did the trust in those people come from? Did it build up over time? Was there this one situation that showed you, yeah, you can really trust that person? And how does it feel to trust that person? It may be this good feeling of knowing you can come back every time when you have a question. You can trust that what they will be doing is good. And it may feel like something that is made for the long term. You can maybe have a doctor that you go to for 20 years already. And then there are the people that we trust with many things, but maybe not with everything. Maybe you have that one colleague that you cannot trust with numbers. Maybe you have that one colleague you cannot trust with buying good cake for the team. And then there are people that we used to trust and that we do not trust anymore. Why? What has happened? Were there many little disappointments, maybe one big disappointment? And this lack of trust, how does that feel? It may feel risky, it may feel unsafe. It may feel like you need to constantly check and rework what that other person is doing. Or if it's a doctor, it may feel like you need to go to a different doctor and check, double check what they say. And it's definitely not something that feels like it's made for the long term. It may even feel like you need to end that relationship. And yeah, it's dangerous to trust too much sometimes. You can be betrayed, you can be disappointed. But it's also problematic to trust too little, because it makes everything so exhausting when you constantly need to check, to monitor, when everything feels risky, and you may end up never knowing when to trust. And yeah, trust is at the core of relationships. It's what makes them enjoyable. It's what makes them for the long term. It's what moves us closer and what keeps societies together. And the lack of trust is basically, yeah, the opposite. It drives us apart. And in the end, we may end relationships because we do not trust anymore. And as a person who is doing research on AI, or more on the people using AI, I can tell you this trust thing, it can feel pretty similar. And it is pretty similar. Trust builds up over time, trust gets violated, trust reduces, and too much trust in AI can be problematic. Too little trust is also not good. And at points, it may even feel similar, like your trust in your doctors or your colleagues. And nowadays, it can feel as if the entire world is yelling at us, you have to trust AI. You have to use it. But what if I don't want to? Come on, all your colleagues, all your friends are using it. You will be left behind. You will be the one weirdo still taking 20 minutes to write an email, and then even with spelling errors. We may all know some of those AI believers, the people who really would wish to use AI for everything. And we may also know people that when you tell them you use AI, they will look at you like, are you insane? You cannot do that. Don't you know there are privacy issues? People lose their ability to think for themselves when they use AI. Some people even died because of AI. And yeah, maybe we know some of the deep skeptics that really would want that entire hype to be just over. Please end it. Or the AI believers. And today, I don't want to give you any good reason why you should be an AI believer or why you should be an AI skeptic. I also don't want to give you tech bro prompt engineering advice for how to make your life more productive. What I want is I want to invite you to a journey of what's behind those things that seem to divide the entire world into believers and skeptics. At times, it can feel as if DAI has just been invented. 2 years ago, ChatGPT, and now everybody's talking about AI. But that field is much older. And it's interesting to see that what has been considered AI 10 years ago is not considered to be AI anymore. And maybe what's AI today will not be considered AI in 2 years from now. And over the years, there have been many, many ups and downs. In the 70s and the 90s, people were really convinced that AI will solve all problems of the world. This is so great. We can use it for medicine. We can use it in production. It will make life much easier, and then disappointment. Not good enough, too costly, maybe even dangerous to use it. And then there were AI winters. We had several AI winters in the past where nobody, except for some hardcore research nerds, were still talking about this, were still thinking about it, were still working on it. I mean, yeah, movies and series have never really given up on the idea of AI as being the best thing ever or destroying mankind. And what have these hardcore nerds achieved by now? We have AI-based systems in medicine that make diagnosis much quicker, much more accurate than humans could ever do. And they have time. You can talk to those systems and they will respond, and you can talk to them for 24 hours compared to your doctor who only has 2 minutes, and then they say, sorry, I gotta hurry to the next patient. And I think I don't need to tell anyone about the potentials that come with generative AI, ChatGPT, Midjourney. And the last thing that blew my mind was an AI for making podcasts out of PDFs. I just uploaded one of my research papers, and after 2 minutes, a podcast came out where two people were talking to each other, including emotions. They made fun of my paper. They said what they found intriguing. They said, yeah, it was really crazy to listen to, because they said, okay, this is impossible, that it's so good, so convincing. It's really hard to discern what's real and what's not. And it's still going on. I mean, researchers are working on those things to be fairer, to be more accurate, to be more sustainable, to use less energy. So eventually to make systems that are more trustworthy, systems that we can trust. And all the potentials that AI has, this also comes with, clearly, companies who invest a lot of money into building the one AI to rule them all. The one AI that everybody else has to build upon. And there's a lot of human work involved. Programmers sitting there 14 hours a day, gathering all the data that is available on Earth to train those systems. We have humans sitting there who have to interact with those systems, to tell those systems what are good outputs, what are problematic outputs, what outputs are sexist, racist, because all those these things, they can happen. And people train them to not do that. Unfortunately, those are often underpaid workers, but that's a different topic, a problematic topic. And because of all the potential that AI has, governments around the world are right now thinking, should we actually regulate that stuff? It seems to be risky to have this AI in every aspect of our lives, in our schools, universities, in hiring, in law. It seems to be risky to just let it go without regulation. And this is right now going on. You may have heard that the European Union has just this year implemented or agreed upon the AI Act, which is the first legislation specifically for AI. It calls for testing, for auditing, for quality standards, for human oversight, that people have to check those systems for whether they are good or not. And this is just the tip of the iceberg. There are companies giving themselves ethical guidelines on how they want and how they do not want to use AI. Every day there's a new update coming out, a new update for a new tool. New tools are coming out, new research papers are coming out, new legislation is coming out. And are we feeling overwhelmed by now? Because I do. I'm allowed, I have the privilege to research that stuff every day, and I'm feeling very much overwhelmed. It's impossible to keep pace. Every day, a new tool. Every day, 500 new papers. Every day, a new regulation popping out somewhere, and you just sit there like, oh God, I cannot handle that. How should I deal with that? And at times, it can feel really as if we are just passive recipients in that. We just sit there, and somebody comes to us, here, AI, use it. And in these situations, it can be very easy to either close your eyes, do not use anything, be a deep skeptic, and just hope this will all be over soon. If I just close my eyes for long enough, it will be over soon. And it's another easy solution to be like, okay, I just use whatever you want, I will just use it for my entire life, okay, everything is AI now. But it's actually not so passive. We are very active, or we play a very active role in this. Because those AI-based systems, they are built for you, for me, they are built for us, they are built for people in the end. And what companies, what researchers are trying to do is they try to build these systems for people. Researchers trying to make them better and better and more trustworthy. Companies are trying that those things are really giving some value to people. Clearly, there are black sheep that just want to sell you the latest new AI to get some money back from you. But in the end, what they try to do is they try, let's imagine these things like platforms to stand upon. Maybe some of you have been to the physiotherapist, and the physiotherapist tells you, here's a platform, it's a little bit shaky, stand upon it. And you stand in front of that platform and say, I can't stand up, it's impossible, I can't do that. Companies and researchers are trying to build those platforms, and regulation is trying to make those platforms a little less shaky, so you can try for yourselves to stand on those platforms. They're on the market, they're regulated, so it may be okay to just stand upon them and feel for yourself, okay, how does it feel to stand on that platform? And I trust you that you can trust yourselves to really stand on these platforms and experience them for yourselves. See what is good for you. See what you find convincing. See what you find not very convincing. You may even learn something about yourselves. What kind of tasks do I enjoy? And I don't want them to be done by AI. What kind of tasks do I enjoy even more with such an AI-based systems? And what kind of tasks I really find not enjoyable, and I'm really happy that this AI-based system is helping me with that. On my way to Berlin here, I used one of these AI-based systems again for writing. And it was really helping me a lot, saved me tons of time. And last week, I prepared for the talk with an AI-based system, and that was just a waste of time. It was much better to talk to people about that, to the coaches, to the colleagues, to get feedback from actual people. The AI wasn't really helpful for that. But without trying it, I wouldn't have known it. So I had some kind of a informed experience of, okay, where do I find that good and where not? And I think these experiences are important to have. And if you have those experiences, or if you feel lost because at some point you say, I have no idea if that's good, not good, what kind of tools there are on the market, it may be an idea to ask your friends, your colleagues, what kind of tools have they used? Because it's, as I said, completely impossible to know everything and to keep pace with it. But maybe your friends, your colleagues know something new. And together you can explore what is happening there. You can find out what is good, what is not so good. One of the best experiences that I had was I created a song with a music AI for a friend's birthday. It was a heavy metal style hymn praising his gaming skills. Absolute banger. And in the days afterwards, my friends and I, we were really sharing some of our creations with each other. Some of them great, some of them boring, some of them incredibly weird. And at some point we realized this is getting a little repetitive. It's not really so creative. And most of the things were just mediocre. Okay, yeah, it was music, it was a song, but it really depended on that one person sitting in front of that system that something really good came out of it. Or it depended on 2-3 people talking about it that something really good and not just mediocre came out of it. So, I would say, trust yourselves, because I trust you that you can trust yourselves to try create texts, try to create a song. Just use some of the free things and then share your experiences with your colleagues and friends. Because colored by our own skepticism, colored by our own enthusiasm, we can then better know what we find good, what we find not so good. We can create feedback to our colleagues, to our friends about those things. And we may end up knowing, this is not so good, we should just use this. This is a task that we do not want to do with an Airbus system. It makes more sense to do it for yourselves or with your colleagues. You can create feedback also for researchers, for policymakers, to in the end build systems that are better and more trustworthy, worth your trust. And it is really, and it's important to remember, about the person sitting in front of this thing, interacting with this thing, sharing their experiences with their friends, with their own competence, with their own creativity, that something that comes out of such an AI-based system will be really good. It will not just be magic that something great comes out of it. It will be mediocre. But with you, and with you sharing your experiences with friends, something really good will come out of it. And this basically was a psychologist talking about AI. Whether you trust me or not, I trust you that you can trust yourselves, whether you trust me. Thanks.